All right. Our third special sense is going to be vision. And vision gets a little more complicated than taste and smell. And we actually have this very complicated organ, the eye, that's going to help us take information in about the outside world. Now, a lot of the anatomical structures of the eye you'll be learning in lab. You will be dissecting a cow eyeball to learn that, right? And a lot of kind of the overall structures that we see externally, you're probably pretty familiar with, right? So you might not call it a palpebra, you might call it an eyelid, right? But you know that it's there, right? Your eyelashes protecting your eye. The pupil, I actually find a lot of people don't really understand, right? The pupil is not a dark dot, but in fact a hole into your eye, right? The iris here, the colored portion of your eye, can kind of open and close, and that determines how much light enters this hole and lands on the retina. A couple other things that you probably won't be able to see as you're dissecting that cow eyeball is understanding how tears work, right? So the lacrimal gland is the tear gland. It's located on the superior lateral aspect of the eye. They say it's about the size of an almond, right? And that's where your tears are produced. Now, these are going to flush across the eye and actually to be removed, right, down in that kind of pink medial area of the eye, you actually have two little holes called the lacrimal punctum, right? So these are, again, are holes, they're pores. The tears are actually going to drain through those holes into the lacrimal sac, right? So the gland, the part producing the tears, is here. The sac is collecting those tears, right? And then those are actually going to enter the nasolacrimal duct and drain into the nasal cavity. So if you've ever been crying, right? If there's too many tears, they can't all get taken in by the punctum. They're going to spill over onto your face. But those that are making it down into that lacrimal sac and nasolacrimal duct are part of why your nose starts running as well. Good times, right? Another thing that they point out in the book, which I think is really interesting, is that actually at the base of the eyelashes, you have some sebaceous glands. So they're producing more oils, right? The tears tend to be very liquidy. The tears contain enzymes, like they point out lysozyme, right, coming out of your tears. This is an enzyme that helps break down bacteria, right, protect the eyes from infection. You add that to the more fats from these sebaceous glands, right, and that's going to produce the tears, really the combination there that are bathing the eye. The other thing that you can see on this image, which are going to be hard on a cow eye, is how what we call the extrinsic eye muscles, right? So these are the muscles attaching to the outside of the eye. They attach to the sclera, the white of the eye, and they're going to pull. And it's kind of interesting, right? So this is, for example, you don't have to memorize these. This is the inferior rectus muscle, right? So it, when it contracts, it can pull your eyes to look down, right? And you have a superior as well. But then you also have these oblique muscles that can kind of help pull your eye on an angle. You may never have paid attention to it before, how precisely your eye can move in all directions, right? But it's thanks to a multitude of extrinsic eye muscles. And if you recall your cranial nerves, there are quite a few different cranial nerves that actually innervate those eye muscles. So we have a lot of control over that movement. I'll move on. This stuff's just really interesting. Okay, so we're going to move on and kind of start looking a little bit more at the inside setup of the eye. Again, pointing out, right, the pupil, right, is actually this hole where light is going to enter. You do have a covering over it, right? This isn't like a hollow entrance into your eye. The cornea is going to be the protective layer in front of the pupil. We need light to pass through this lens and get projected out onto this giant screen in the back of the eye called the retina. So the three layers that you need to know for me are the fibrous layer, the vascular layer, and the inner layer, or the retina. And so we'll go through these. So this fibrous layer, right, this is the outside of the eye, and it really has these two components, the cornea and the sclera. So the sclera is the what you would call the white of your eye, right? Both of these in the fibrous layer are these really tough connective tissue layers. They're there to protect the eye. And then the sclera also acts as the site for the attachment of those extrinsic eye muscles. The cornea is very similar, tough material, but of course it needs to be clear since it's covering right where the images are actually going to enter the eye. The cornea doesn't have any blood vessels so that it's clear, and so it's really going to be the tears, right, diffusion from those tears that are actually nourishing the cells there of the cornea. Okay, the next layer, our vascular layer, has a couple important components. This first one is the iris, right? And we're all looking at this stuff that's kind of in cream. The iris is the colored portion of your eye, right? And the coloration there just depends on how much melanin you produce. So typically, not always, but typically, if you have lots of melanin, right? If you have dark hair, darker skin tones, you tend to produce that same amount of melanin, and that'll show up in your iris as well, right? Typically, if you are more pale, it's because you don't produce much melanin in your skin, and the same thing will happen here in the iris, and you tend to have a blue eye, a lighter colored iris. But more important than eye color, the iris's purpose is to change the aperture of the pupil, right? How open or closed that pupil is, how much light is actually entering the eye. The ciliary body, you'll see this when you dissect the eye. It kind of has these little ridges, which I think is where they came up with the name here. But a couple things, the ciliary body is actually who's producing a fluid called aqueous humor. That aqueous humor kind of fills this anterior cavity, helps keep the eye's shape the same. The ciliary body also has these little attachments to the lens, and it's the ciliary body that pulls on the lens and helps to change its shape, which determines your ability to focus an image onto the retina. So typically, as you get older and the lens starts to lose a little bit of its pliability, it becomes harder and harder to force that image in the right location to get it to land on the retina, and you start to see maybe the need for some corrective lenses. Of course, some folks, that hasn't worked for a long time, right, been wearing glasses or contacts to correct vision. Okay, this innermost layer then, kind of in this peachish color, is the retina, right? And what we're gonna see with the retina, notice it says the neural part. We'll look at this much closer here, but the retina is the part of your eye that contains the rods, which are able to sense light and dark, and the cones, which actually give you your color vision. Right, and so here we see this example of light entering, right? Notice the pupil is this actual hole. The iris has determined its diameter, but that image is gonna pass through the lens, and ideally that image gets focused right on the retina. So here in this image, they're doing a nice job as well of showing you the sclera. There's a blood vessel in there, right? In this outer layer there, the choroid, which I apparently didn't talk about. The ciliary body, right up here by the lens, but the extension of that here is this choroid. You can see the really rich blood supply in there. It's really going to be taking care of the underlying retina. The retina stretches around the whole back of the eye, but really your images are trying to be focused on this one particular spot called the fovea, and the fovea is actually the area of the retina where you have the largest concentration of rods and cones. Now, where you really don't want the image to focus is just a little bit to the side here. This is what we call the optic disc. All the nerves from the retina need to leave the eye, and they do so here in the optic nerve, but where that optic nerve is, Notice we don't have retina kind of covering that portion of the eye to receive visual information. It's that optic disc where the optic nerve is leaving that actually leads to this phenomenon that we call a blind spot. Okay, so here we're looking at how the pupil is able to open and close, right? It's just a sphincter. Now, the other thing, and the reason I actually included this, because I figured you could kind of picture a pupil dilating or constricting, but they remind us that the sympathetic nervous system, that fight or flight response, as you're trying to bring in as much information as possible, those pupils get really dilated, right? When you're more relaxed, that pupil can be much smaller, right? You're not trying to gather as much information about the outside world. Okay, so let's take a closer look here. We'll just erase this. At the actual retina, right? So again, just to kind of see where we are here, we're in the back of the eye, right? And they're trying to show you here that that retinal layer, there are a ton of neurons. Let's see if we can zoom in here. This is what the eye doctor actually sees when they look into your eyes at a visual exam, right? Here is the optic disc, the portion that does not have vision. And then this is the fovea, that area of more concentrated rods and cones for your best vision. Okay, I guess before we talk about the actual physiology, we'll look a little bit more at how the lens works, right? So what they're pointing out, and this image doesn't, I don't know that they made it super obvious, but they're trying to point out that the lens changes shape and that changes where the image is portrayed, right? And you are trying to always get that image onto the retina, right? So here we see it kind of nice and plump and round because we are looking up at something close and we're able to focus that image right on the retina, right? So you might be able to read something right here. You'll notice, I don't know if your parents did this as well, but mine started like holding things out here, trying to see, right? They couldn't get that lens to actually focus on the retina, right? It starts kind of falling short, and so they're moving that a little bit further away to get it to focus, right? Distant vision, we actually pull. Here you see that ciliary body actually pulling on the lens, again, getting that to focus on the retina. If this isn't working, right, we call myopia when someone is nearsighted, right? So up close images might appear clear, nice and crisp and clear, but as they try to look at things that are further away, that image is falling kind of in front of the retina. Sometimes this has to do, if you've been wearing glasses or contacts for a long time, sometimes this has to do with just the shape of the eye, right? If your eye is like less rounded and maybe longer, maybe it's harder to get that image on the retina. It's falling right here. And so if that image falls here, by the time it gets back to the retina, how do I do this? Yeah. It's kind of fanning out again. And so it's gonna hit the retina but be blurry. So myopia is nearsightedness. For people that are farsighted, hyperopia. Right? They can see far away nice and clearly, but when they try to read something up close, it's difficult, and so they're maybe holding it further away. Other things that happen with vision, right? Since you're attempting to focus that image on the retina, it's going through this lens, and so here's one of those like sensation versus perception sort of things, right? All images are actually flipped upside down when they land on your retina. It's your brain that actually corrects this image so that you see it as things are in reality. Things are also switched left to right, right? So it's going through this prism that's basically flipping and flipping an image. We see images that reflect light off of them, but really in a fairly narrow band of what we call the electromagnetic spectrum, right? Some organisms, like honeybees, can actually see into the ultraviolet. They have receptors that cover a wider range of this electromagnetic spectrum. This is what we consider visible, because the visible light spectrum, because that's what humans have receptors for, right? So we can see colors all the way from red. Do you remember Regibiv? Red, orange, yellow, green, blue, indigo, violet, Regibiv. I feel like that was like a middle school thing. Right, so we can see things with as high a frequency as kind of this violet over here, and as low frequency as a red. Okay, so here's how the vision thing actually works. This is the cool part. So look at our retina here. Notice the light is coming in from the eyeball, and this is the weirdest thing. You'd expect the receptors to be right there on the retina, but they're not. The light actually passes through the retina, past all of these different neurons, and then here are your rods and cones. Rods and cones. Interesting, huh? There's an actual microscopic image. Ooh, and we can zoom in a little bit further. Now, a couple things to point out to you here. Right, again, you're passing all of these neurons. You might recognize when we first talked about neurons, we said there was a type called a bipolar cell, but they're relatively rare. Here we are in the retina looking at our little bipolar cells. This bipolar cell is really taking the information from the rods or cones, right, and passing it on to other neurons. But it is an important sensory neuron here with vision. But again, this is just so interesting to me, because we picture that this image is coming in through the lens and being kind of portrayed on the retina. And in fact, it actually has to go through the retina to get to those actual receptors. Any of that excess light then is passed into kind of what they're calling this pigmented part of the retina, and just kind of absorbed all those extra photons. Now, some organisms, like your cow, they have an extra layer. Remember, the choroid then is just outside of this, right, in that vascular layer. The choroid in some organisms is actually translucent, iridescent is the word I want, kind of like mother of pearl. And you hopefully saw that in the cow eye. So what's happening there is there actually any extra light is kind of getting passed back to the receptors. And that's super important actually in night vision. So if you've ever noticed that if you shine a flashlight, you see a reflection of the eyes of cats and dogs and cows and elk and all those sorts of things, but actually humans don't do that, right? Humans don't have that reflective layer, and so our eyes don't have that shine. What we do have is I don't even know, does this happen anymore with digital cameras? Definitely, like, you used to be able to take a picture, and if the flash wasn't right, if someone's pupils are wide open, it's dark, so your flash goes, that light actually goes into the eye and bounces back off the retina, which has a very rich blood supply. They're showing right here. And so you'd get this red eye. I haven't seen that in a while. I'm kind of wondering now if digital cameras do something about that. Anyway, okay, so here we are with rods and cones. Now, the kind of terminal end of both of these is filled with these discs. Right, so that's what they're trying to show you right here, is that you have all these little packets. And as these get worn out and shed, these cells up here in the pigmented epithelium actually go ahead and kind of recycle the components there. And again, here we see that pigmented layer, lots of melanin in there, and trying to absorb the excess light that maybe gets through. Okay. In both, the way vision actually works is that you have a pigment called rhodopsin. So we see it over here. Well, let's just make this bigger for you. Right? So rhodopsin is this molecule embedded? Here you see a phospholipid bilayer. All of these discs have these phospholipid bilayers with rhodopsin embedded in them. Now, rhodopsin is made up of two different parts. It has opsin, which is the protein part. Do you see kind of in purple here, they're trying to show you this folded protein? Okay, that's called opsin. And then here in red, it also contains retinol. Okay, retinol is a form of vitamin A. Right, so if you've ever heard vitamin A is good for your vision, this is why it is, right? Retinol is this component of this overall molecule called rhodopsin. Now, okay, let's look at how this actually works when there's incoming light. Oh, sorry, before we do that, then notice, right, these are the actual, this one's a cone, and here we are synapsing with that bipolar neuron. Okay, so there's your close-up. Again, retinol, opsin make rhodopsin. Right, and you have slightly different cones to pick up on each of our three primary, not even primary, three major colors. So we pick up on, right, red and blue would be primary colors, then yellow. But we don't have a cone for yellow. Instead, we have a cone for green. And then here in black, they're trying to show you that the rods really just pick up in black and white. Okay. Now, the strangest thing about vision, and we'll walk through this, but the strangest thing to me, right, that tends to be hard, it's hard for me to kind of comprehend it, and it tends to then make students struggle, is that when the, here we're showing a rod, when we're in the dark, the sodium channels in the cell membrane of that rod are open. Sodium is rushing in and the rod is depolarizing. When it depolarizes, that's when it sends neurotransmitters across the synapse to the bipolar cell, right? We actually use glutamate as the neurotransmitter here, right? So sodium is rushing in and we're sending a signal to the brain to tell it this is dark. The way we actually see things, this is weird, is by closing those sodium channels, right, and shutting off the signal from those neurotransmitters. So again, I feel like so much of vision is backwards, right? We flip images. Heck, our images are gonna cross as they're going back to our brain. And here we are, the lack of a signal indicates that we're seeing something, where the signal indicates darkness, right? That's our resting state. Let's walk through this real quick. Okay, this image is pretty small, but then we have the zoom ins of these. So notice what's happening here, right? Again, at rest, those sodium channels are open, right? This cell membrane is depolarizing and we're gonna send a message to the bipolar cells. Those neurotransmitters go to that bipolar cell, right? And we send an action potential to the brain. Zoom in. Okay, now when a photon of light hits one of our rods or cones, we are going to make a conformational change in that retinol. It's going to go from a bent shape to a straight shape, right? Cis is just showing this bend, trans is this straight line molecule. So here they're showing that opsin gets activated, right? And this is occurring by a photon. and we see retinol changing shape. I don't even care if you know which one is cis and which one is trans, right? But it changes shapes. Okay? That change in shape is activating this whole rhodopsin. Okay, now, a couple funky terms here, right? But basically what happens, right, they're trying to show that opsin, the protein here, is going to basically activate two enzymes, transducin and PDE is phosphodiesterase. Should I keep my numbers the same as they are? That opsin, the activated opsin, activates, that's maybe weird to say. That activated opsin activates enzymes, but it's what's going on. And these enzymes are transducin and PDE, which is phosphodiesterase. Okay. Those two enzymes, well, the phosphodiesterase is the one then that actually pulls, you remember cyclic AMP? This is a closely related molecule. We'll just call it cyclic AMP, I'm fine with that. Takes the cyclic AMP off of our sodium channel, closing it. So phosphodiesterase, PDE, basically breaks down cyclic, and seriously, I'm fine. It is technically GMP. It's a slightly different sugar. If you want to continue calling it AMP, that's totally fine with me. Right? That's what was keeping the sodium channels open, and so now we're going to see the sodium channels close. When those channels are closed, we're no longer going to be depolarizing the membrane, and we're going to go ahead and decrease the neurotransmitter being sent on to that bipolar cell. Isn't that interesting, right? That I'm going to go back to the big picture, right? So again, in the dark, sodium is entering and we're sending a signal to the bipolar cell. Sodium is entering because that sodium channel is held open by that cyclic AMP. But as soon as that photon of light hits and changes the shape of retinol, right, that vitamin A molecule that activates opsin, right, the activated opsin is releasing those enzymes or activating those enzymes, transducin and PDE. PDE pulls that cyclic AMP off of our sodium channel, closing it, right? And now we don't get any neurotransmitter. And that's when you're seeing something is the lack of a signal. I just think it's so fascinating. Okay, so that is really how vision, in a nutshell, how vision works. Now, a couple other interesting things that happen. There's a phenomenon called bleaching, and you've experienced this before, right? Where you've maybe come in from a bright sunny day, you forgot your sunglasses, you've come in from a bright sunny day, and when you get inside, it's kind of hard to see. And so basically, that's what we call this process of bleaching, right? So again, here, when that photon of light changes the shape of our retinol molecule, in order to be able to see the next image, what we need to do is kind of rejuvenate that rhodopsin. And it doesn't just go back to its original shape. We actually have to break the protein and the pigment part apart. apart, then we're able to rebuild the correct shape of retinol, and we put them back together as rhodopsin again. So bleaching is taking place because this is going to take a little bit of time. So if you've had so many photons of light hitting your eye that you've changed everything to this trans conformation of retinol, it's going to sit there and have to undo all of those molecules, and that period of time that that takes, we're going to see some changes in our vision. And we'll play with that a little bit in class. Okay, so the last thing about vision then is how we actually process it. And so this is an interesting image here showing you how you have this binocular vision, right? You can see things out of your right eye that I can't see out of my left, right? In that case, maybe my nose is in the way, right? But there's some things that only your right eye sees and some things that only your left eye sees. But then there's also this overlap, right? Probably our best vision is more in front of us where we have both eyes being able to send these images back, right? Those images, of course, land on the retina and then are carried on the optic nerve. So if we look at the pathway here, the actual receptor is in the retina, and then we're going to carry that message on the optic nerve, cranial nerve number 3, right? Until, and you'll see this in the cow eye, you hit this optic chiasm where half of the vision crosses to the other side of the brain, but half of the vision stays on the same side of the brain. As we enter the central nervous system, it's no longer a nerve, it's the optic tract, right? And then this is going to go to the thalamus, this lateral geniculate nucleus. Don't worry about that. That is part of the thalamus. And so I'm fine if you go there. The thalamus, of course, being that filter for sensory information, and we see it coming back here to the optic cortex, right, in the occipital lobe of the brain, right? Visual cortex, that's the better term, visual cortex in the posterior brain, right? So whatever makes it to that visual cortex, of course, is the part that's actually entering our consciousness. We also have a couple other places you'll recognize the superior colliculi. Colliculus is singular, but there's two of them. From your lab list. This is where we're going to get some of the reflexive reactions to sights. The other place to realize that this ends up going is that some of the message goes to the pineal gland. Right, so some of this is entering our consciousness. Some of this visual input maybe is reflexive. And then the pineal gland. If you recall, the pineal gland is responsible for circadian rhythms, right? For that sleep-wake cycle. And one of the things that we see happen more and more, right, is that we're on screens all the time bombarding our brain and pineal gland with light and telling them, it's the middle of the day, right? And so it's really important to sleep well, to actually spend some time before bed not being on screens and let that kind of calm hit the pineal gland and tell us it's time to sleep. Okay, we'll play with vision a little bit in class this week, looking at things like bleaching and blind spots.